In my lifetime of being a train enthusiast, I cannot recall one time that I have ever gone rail fanning on National Train Day. I know that sounds very confusing and I don't understand why I never went, but fortunately that would finally change on Saturday, May 7th, 2022. On this day, I finally got the opportunity to spend a whole day trackside watching trains go by one right after another on a day that is dedicated specifically to them. On this particular outing, I chose a spot that I haven't been to in over a year and a half, and yet it's a place that I love very much for the spectacular angles and shots of trains you can get here, and the people are actually quite friendly from my experiences at least. This spot is Colony Park in Hudson, Ohio. As we were pulling out of the driveway, I pulled up Train Mon 5 to see Amtrak's eastbound Lakeshore Limited being lined into Cleveland Amtrak Station. Instead of going directly to Hudson as planned, we made a beeline for Unionville and got there with only 5 minutes to spare. An international paper mill is situated conveniently between the Erie West subdivision of CSX and the Lake Erie district of Norfolk Southern. The parking lot offers great access to both mains. We pulled in to see the headlights of UPS train IO-20 heading eastbound with two Jivos on point. Right on his markers was the 3.5 hour late Amtrak Lakeshore Limited bound for New York and Boston. The signal at CP Unionville was lit up high green. It wouldn't be long until we'd eventually see NS-309 heading west with surprise BNSF foreign leaders up front. We elected to cross over to the other side of the track so my shot of the train wasn't backlit and that the sun would at least be on the side of the locomotives. After the shenanigans in Unionville, we picked up I-90 in Madison and headed to Colony Park, which took about a half an hour. By the time I got up to the bridge, I heard one of my favorite trains on NS call out the signal at the nearby CP-94. A couple minutes later, up came a C6M duo on the helm of westbound 21Z. There really isn't any good words to explain why I like the 21Z so much. I guess it's because it isn't just 13,000 feet of straight-up double stacks, but more of a mixed bag of everything that you can see on any intermodal train. Double stacks, single stacks, TOFC, and COFC. And let's not forget the two big cuts of UPS this train has today. Combine that with everything else it's hauling and the length of the train today, and you get a super hot monster that you cannot delay for any reason. Unless that super hot monster has more empties than loads on it, which does happen from time to time. But fortunately, Rutherford Yard did a good job of building today's train. Only one empty and just over 10,000 feet worth of train. Rutherford Intermodal Terminal in Pennsylvania is where this train originates. From there, it heads to Chicago's 47th Street Yard via the Pittsburgh Line, Mon Line, Cleveland Line, and Chicago Line. It makes a brief stop in Pitcairn Intermodal Facility to do setouts and pickups, and then continues west. Assuming that the train isn't delayed, it's usually loaded, assembled, and ready to head west no earlier than 9:30 p.m. and no later than 10:30 p.m. That's the time slot in which it departs Rutherford and heads west over the Pittsburgh Line, usually passing Horseshoe Curve between midnight and 3 a.m. I would think it arrives in Conway at about 6 or 7 in the morning. From there, it most likely does a crew change and then takes the Cleveland Line west at Rochester. Then it's a 3-hour journey to points such as Rootstown, Ravenna, Hudson, and Macedonia, and 4 hours for points like Northfield, Bedford, Cleveland, and Berea. At that point, it's a daylight run all the way to Chesterton, Indiana, at least, and then it arrives in Chicago 47th, usually overnight or very early in the morning. After it passed, we heard the 21Z roll over the RD-101.6 detector in Macedonia, which read no defects on track 2. About an hour later, we heard it go off again, this time for track 1, meaning that there was an eastbound just clearing Macedonia. About another 5 minutes later, and up came 20R, bound for Port Newark, New Jersey, with a duo of ES-44 DCs on point. R is actually running on time for once. It arrived in Maple Heights at around 7 this morning, did its pickups and drop-offs, and left no later than 11. This train also has to work Harrisburg GI-8 en route to its destination at Port Newark. If it doesn't drop off all of these spare tables, it's probably not going to be allowed to enter Port Newark, and this has happened a couple times that I can recall.
Train, 2 eastbound, Brian, I'll get you alongside your train down the street.
Autostat trains aren't all that common of an occurrence anymore on Class 1 railroads. They really haven't been from the get-go, but they've always been there. And fortunately, today was my lucky day to see my first one in years with the combination of 25V and 11N. Right before 25V showed up, we heard the sound of 16G rolling over the detector at 101.6 over the radio. This meet ended up turning out pretty good under the bridge, and 16G was a really good train today, 31 of those John Deere tractors on flat cars. Those will be heading to Conway Yard to be picked up by 36A and dropped off at Enola, where 24M is going to pick them up and take them all the way to Baltimore. Also note the lead motor of 16G, NS4368, equipped with a Nathan K3 LA air horn, sounding like it's off of either BNSF or UP. Here's another reason why I like Colony Park so much. You're usually guaranteed to see at least one mother and or father bring their children to see if they can catch a train on the bridge. That would be the case for me today. A mother brought her daughter and her son up to the bridge to see if they could see anything, and this meet ended up happening right under them. It was so much fun and wholesome to watch the kids freak out and get all excited that two trains were going by at the exact same time. After all, it's not all that common, and now the daughter wants to take a train to New York. Up next on our list is NS26E, highballing east with a UP Gevo third out and what's either my third or fourth catch of the Hub Group 50th anniversary container. I'm starting to lose track now. Right behind 26E was NS20E with another UP motor second out. I didn't notice it at the time, but that would eventually turn out to be an AC6000 rebuild trailing. I wish I'd have gotten a better shot of it. Thank you. That's the distant sound of NS8120's new Leslie RS5T horn as it pulls 13,000 feet worth of 21Q up the hill. Wrapping up our national train day is NS24M, daily UPS out of Chicago's 63rd Street for Bayview Yard in Baltimore. That huge block of J.B. Hunt up front, along with a huge chunk of the UPS consist, will be dropped off in Pitcairn, and that usually leaves 24M with about 10 cars or less, sometimes more on a good day.